Good to see everyone here this morning. We just have a few announcements. I think most of them in your bulletin if you want to go through them with me. There'll be a Sunday lunch fundraiser today at the Senior Citizen Center, sponsored by the Methodist Church, starting at 11. The graveside funeral at Roy Cemetery for Ronald Cox, I think it's at 2 p.m. This afternoon. Please be in prayer for their whole family. We will have a thankful Christmas fellowship meal on Sunday, December 13th. After our worship service, their sign-up sheets will be available soon. Talk to Shirley in Indiana for more information. Sunday night groups will meet together Sunday, November 29th at 6 p.m. There will be a wedding shower for Andy Terrell and Zach Eckert on November 22nd. And there is a new issue of the newsletter in the foyer if you haven't received a copy of it yet. Any other announcements? You'll stand with me, please. Read our scripture from Ephesians 5, 1 through 2. Therefore,
be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning and we thank you, Father, for just all the blessings in our lives. And Father, as those around us, our loved ones, hurt, Father, we just pray that you would be with them this morning. And Father, we just thank you so much for your Son and his sacrifice for us. Father, as we lift our voices to you this morning, Father, we just pray that it'll be a joyful noise. And it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
God is healer, awesome in power, our God. two or more are gathered in my name, there I'll be also. And I believe he's here right now this morning. I was driving from between Waldron and Mena Friday afternoon, coming through the Washita Mountains, the Washita National Forest, admiring, if you, I'm sure y'all have drove through that part of the country this time of the year, the trees and God's grandeur is just overwhelming almost. And as I was admiring his creation, Chris Tomlin's "How Great Is Our God" came on. You know, just the power of God. You could just tell he was there, you know, listening. It's almost indescribable. And then you come this morning and you hear a solemn service like this. There's nowhere else I'd rather be than right here, right now. And I hope that each of you feels that same. And I hope that everyone here has felt God touch their heart. We're living in some uncertain times, but there's the fundamentals that we go back to, and that is we have a God that keeps his promises. During times of trouble and toil, we're told are coming, but every Sunday morning we can gather in his name and we can meet at the foot of the cross and around his table, and we can be reassured of his promises and that he is a God that keeps those promises.
Amen.
So I invite you now to join me at the foot of the cross as we partake of the bread and the blood of Christ.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful and thankful for this opportunity to meet around your table this morning. Father, as we remember your son's sacrifice on that cross, Father, we remember his body that was broken for us and his blood that was shed on that cross. Father, please help us to take this in a manner that's pleasing to you, Father, glorifying you. And so we pray. Amen. Amen.
Luke chapter 22, verse 19. He took the bread, when he given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." And as Paul says to the Corinthians, in eating this bread and drinking this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. At this time, I'd like to invite the kids to come on up before they go to children's church. So how many of you like getting things that are like battery operated and remote controlled, like cars and drones and things like that? Who likes playing with that stuff? Okay, it's pretty much everybody. You guys like playing with drones? Like those things that fly up and down? I'm not talking like bees, that's scary. So before you play with those things though, what should you read or have your parents read and look at so you understand how it works? The directions, the instructions, the manual. Because, like, think about it. How many of you have tried using something without the manual? Or, I'm pretty sure the daddies in the room are going to hate me for this, but I got to admit it. How many of us dads have opened it up and took it out and played with it right away and almost broke or have broken toys your kids have gotten? I'm willing to admit it. Lord have mercy on me, I'm a sinner. But see, the reason why it comes with a manual is so that you don't what? Break it. Who needs the manual? Apparently, everybody. See, there's the thing. We have this attitude on life about the same way. Did you know there is a manual for life? Does anyone know what that manual for life is? The Bible. And many Christians, many people who say they believe in God, we treat God with that attitude. Who needs the manual?
Everybody.
Hey, I'm glad you answered a rhetorical question with such a great answer. But see, that's what we do. God actually tells us what he wants. In the book of Romans, it says we can know what God's will is. We can know what God wants for us. But the thing is, many of us, we like to say things like, well, we don't understand what God wants for us, but we let our Bible sit on our nightstand or on our bookshelf or things like that. And you guys, even at your age, did you know that some of the prophets and some of the people in the Bible, they weren't much older than you, and Samuel might have been as old as some of you are when God called him. So I want you guys to think about this. Who here owns a Bible or has one in their house? Who here sometimes gets confused about life? I mean, adults, we should all be raising our hands, right? Did you know, the more we get into the Word of God, the more God will pour those answers into us as to what our lives should be like. Maybe not necessarily what we should be doing. God's not going to look at you and say, I want you to go and be an electrician, and you're going to be a plumber, and you're going to be a teacher. You know, God doesn't do those things per se. But he can tell us how to be those things and serve and honor and glorify him in everything we do. Does that make sense?
And how to learn to do it.
And how to learn to do it, sure. Well, I've never found an instruction in the Bible that tells me how to be a plumber. But it tells me how to be a follower of Christ in any circumstance I'm in. So I want y'all to consider that, okay? I want you guys to go home. Here's my challenge. Don't go home right now because your parents have to stay here. But when you go home, I want you to consider some Bible reading stuff. And maybe ask your moms and your dads. And you guys start getting involved with that. And maybe do it as a family. And you're going to find that the more that you get into the Word of God, the more the Word of God actually gets into you. Okay? Those instructions are important. Open them. All right. Love you guys. Have a great week. Or great service. There we go. I'm always amazed how every 2 to 4 years It seems that sometimes we Christians forget how to be followers of Christ. Think about it. Even within our own body here, we are maybe even, at least along political lines, a little divided. And the way in which Christians bash people that are made in the very image of Christ, in the image of God Himself, according to both Genesis and James chapter 3. Ooh, that's a hard book to open up this time of the cycle of politics. We praise God with our lips and then put someone down made in His image. But that's not the function of the body of Christ. All too often, I wonder, what if Christians talked about Jesus, or Christians spent their time in the Word and spreading the gospel as we did talking about politics? What would that look like? What would the church look like if we invested that time, if we invested all of that energy into God and His Word and building His kingdom? What would our churches look like? I'm going to tell you something. You cannot know the will of God apart from the Word of God. The verse of the day is not reading your Bible. And oftentimes, here's what we do too, is as believers, we use the Word of Bible not as a sword to fight spiritual forces over this heavenly darkness, or over this present darkness, but as a club to beat people over the head with. The purpose of the body of Christ is unity. Next week we'll talk about the family, and the week after we're going to talk about spiritual warfare. But really, when I'm preaching these things and I'm hearing this, this is supposed to be a place where everyone is equal through the cross of Christ. Paul writes to the Romans and to the Galatians and elsewhere, and Jesus talks about this, and Peter talks about this, and John talks about this. There is no division within Christ. Paul writes specifically, there is no Jew, nor Gentile, nor male, nor female, nor slave, nor free. All are one in Christ. There isn't a left-wing body of Christ and a right-wing body of Christ. There is just the body. I'm brokenhearted because I see the way people talk about one another. The way we put someone down who is made in the image of the invisible God. That doesn't speak to us. That speaks of really what we think of His work. And we need to be patient because God is patient with us. The rest of the world that is unbelieving should not be expected to know the will of God because they've hardened their hearts to it. Let's all stand and read this today. Listen to these words. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17. Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as Gentiles do, in the futilities of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardness of their hearts. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to the practice of every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you heard about Him and were taught in Him as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Please be seated. Do you hear the newness here? When we give our lives to Christ, here's what we do. The reason why baptism is so important is it's not merely a washing. It's a putting to death of the flesh. We are saying, I am giving my life to Christ. I am crucifying my flesh along with Christ. I am burying my flesh with Him. And I am rising a new creation. Well, I'm going to tell you something. Jesus says the new and the old cannot live together.
And how often do I walk in my own flesh? Do I get angry when I'll be honest with you, the Lord has to like pretty much slap my fingers every single day when I'm on social media posting something for the church. I've got to stop myself from saying the things I want to say. Because that's not who I am anymore. Once I lived as a Gentile, I lived in sensuality. I lived to please my flesh. I lived to get my due. I'm going to tell you something about Brian Doyle that you may not know or believe, but it's the truth. I'm arrogant. I am. I pride myself in my flesh of being the smartest kid in the room. I would often shut people up in arguments. Why? Because as a young boy, I grew up in a sea of estrogen, and the only real male influence I had, it was great having my dad, but his adult friends. And I would sit and listen to them talk politics and talk history and all that stuff. That affects a kid when that's all his friends are above the age of 30 and 40. And so I grew up being the smartest kid in the room because I listened to these guys who were very intellectual. And I knew how to argue. And I knew how to be right. And unfortunately, I've plowed people over and even maybe buried a few with my attitudes. That's the way of my flesh. We talked about this at our Sunday evening Bible study in the book of James, and I want y'all to hear this. This is vitally important. James chapter 3. Who is wise and understanding among you? Here's the part that hurts. By his good conduct, let him show his work with meekness and wisdom. This is a word we don't understand in the church anymore, meekness. We've taken that word meek and applied it to weakness. That's not what meekness is. Amen. Jesus was meek, but he was never weak. Amen. Jesus had the right and the ability, he even said, to call 12 legions of angels down to rescue him. So he told Peter to put up his sword. When they came to arrest him, they said, "Are you Jesus of Nazareth?" He said, "I am." And they all withdrew and fell on their faces. And yet Jesus walked away with them, allowing them to think they had arrested him. Meekness is having the right and the ability, but the wisdom to not do. To put God's will before my own. Paul says, "All things are legal for me, but not all things are beneficial." But James continues in this, "But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. That is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder in every vile practice." Does that sound familiar to anyone? "But the wisdom from above is first pure, then," wait for it, "peaceable." Peaceable. Gentle. Open to reason. Full of mercy and good fruits. Impartial and sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Church, how we act and what we say and what we act based upon what we say is vitally important. Amen. Jesus said, "You will know a tree by its fruits." If you were to look at your social media, or heck, if you were to have a hidden camera show follow you around, what fruits would you be showing? I'm not the spiritual fruit inspector. But the Word of God tells me that my conduct is vitally important. Why? Because I claim Christ. And if I claim Christ, I need to act as Christ. Amen. In Philippians chapter 2, Paul writes, "Each one of you should have the same attitude of Christ Jesus, who did not count equality with God as something to be grasped, but he humbled himself, taking on the form of a slave." That hurts me. And I hope it hurts you hearing those words. Why? Because arrogant, prideful Brian Doyle needs to be on his face before Almighty God. And a hardness of heart comes from one thing, a lack of humility.
Amen.
And right now, too many people, some of us in this room, and I am confessing my own sin to you that I am one of them, are so concerned with being right that we forget that we're supposed to be righteous. The ways of the flesh are not godly. Responding the way the rest of the world is not what Jesus would do. Maybe we should bring back all those bracelets we used to wear in the 90s, WWJD. But here's the thing. In order to know what Jesus would do, we have to get into the Word that talks about what Jesus did. And too many of us were willing to post something online that sounds Christian. I'm going to tell you, one of the things that bothers me the most is, this is what God has for you today. But they don't quote Scripture or even remotely close to anything being. The world and everything in it is going to try and counterfeit what Christ does, because the world is always contrary to Jesus. Amen. It has been from the first rebellion. And so what do we need to do? We need to get into the pure Word of God. We need to go back to Psalm 119 and pray for the spirit of the psalmist. Lord, your Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And over and over and over he wrote, I delight in the law of the Lord. What if we delighted in this? And yes, it's going to take some time. But this should inform our perspective on the world. The world has always been corrupt. The world has always been broken. But Jesus Christ is the same yesterday as he is today, as he will be tomorrow.
Amen.
So believers, I'm asking you, I'm imploring you, put away the filthiness, the anger, the jealousy. And get to the Word of God and let us get back to the business of the gospel. Every single day, we go home to a neighborhood where people are unsaved. People's eternities on the balance. But we're focused about yard signs that talk about political candidates, or we're focused about our jobs, or we're focused about our kids, or we're focused about our pantries, or all these other things. Jesus says, why do you worry about what you're going to eat or what you're going to drink or what you're going to wear? And he ends this beautiful poem about how there's not a bird that falls from the sky that the Lord doesn't know about. He feeds them all. And the grass of the field, which is here today and thrown in the fire, even Solomon in all his splendor doesn't compare with the beauty of God's creation. He says, how much more valuable are you than all that? The Gentiles and the pagans seek after all those things. But he says, you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Then all these things, all these needs you have in your life will be added unto you. And I'm going to tell you, this is true. Being a preacher and never having any means, the Lord has provided for every single one of my needs. I have never been without. My kids have clothing on their back. God bless us with four boys so we can just pass stuff right on down. But my hope and my trust is in nothing less than Jesus Christ. And he has provided for all of my needs. I may have gone without some things I've wanted. I might have skipped a meal or two in my lifetime. But I have never been without, because Jesus Christ never fails. And so, church, we need to realize that we do not have to be like the rest of the world.
Amen.
Let us focus on putting off the old self and to be renewed in the spirit of our minds. Let us be imitators of Christ. He continues, verse 24, therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor. For we are members of one another. Now, let's consider what he means by that. Why is he telling us to speak the truth with one another? Because we've seen what happens when churches allow sin to creep in. We've seen what happens in the so-called progressive Christian movement when they start moving away from the scriptures and start appeasing and feeding the appetite of the flesh. You see churches fall. You see Christians fall. It happens one tiny compromise at a time. And so we need to speak the truth to each other. And I'm going to tell you something. I've had this conversation with some folks, and some folks have had this conversation with me. It's hard to have a conversation that begins like this. I love you, but I've got to tell you what's on my mind. Used to be, we had a bunch of little old ladies who would sit in the church, and some of y'all grew up thinking about, and you could think about those little old ladies who weren't afraid to speak their minds and tell you where you were going wrong. Some of you are here today because of those giants of faith. It used to be that the church, people would show up at your door and say, "Brother, where have you been? We miss you, and we're worried about you." Now, in a day and age where we have devices in our pockets where we don't have to even meet face to face, yet still we can talk to each other face to face, we don't use it for the purpose it was really built for. We need to speak the truth to each other. Amen. James says that if anyone brings back an unrighteous man, he has done a good thing. It is time for us to start caring enough to love each other, to speak the truth in love. That famous story of Jesus in John chapter 8, the woman caught in adultery, Jesus never excused her sin. As a matter of fact, he said, "Where are those who condemn you?" She said, "There are none." He says, "Neither do I condemn you, but go and sin no more." The man that Jesus healed at the pool of Bethsaida when he was healed and carrying his mat on the Sabbath day and offended all the Pharisees, Jesus caught him again. He said, "You better be careful. If you keep sinning, something worse is going to happen to you." Jesus wasn't afraid to call out sin, and we need to stop using that excuse, "Well, that was Jesus." Jesus put the Holy Spirit in us. And if we read the Word of God, we know what is right and we know what is wrong, and we can correct each other in truth and love. The body of Christ was not designed so you could fill a spot on Sunday morning. It was designed to be a community of believers who build each other up. Believers, it's time we start doing it again. It's time we start looking at each other and loving each other enough to risk friendships because we love them that much. If you saw your friend walking in the middle of the street with some headphones on, and a logging truck was barreling right at him, would you do everything you could to push them out of the way? Risking your own life? Why don't we do that for spiritual things too? It is time we speak the truth in love. For we are members of one another. Listen to what he says. Be angry. Be angry. But the second half is kind of hard. And do not sin. Give no opportunity. Or sorry, he says, be angry, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Anger is a righteous attitude. It's something God invented, but we use it in all the wrong ways. Brian Doyle, confessing his sin. "I like to kill a fly on the wall with a bazooka if I'm able." We shouldn't let our anger turn to unrighteousness. Amen. We shouldn't let our anger become something that causes people to say, "Well, those Christians, that's all they do is judge." Now, they're going to say that no matter what, because guess what? The Word of God, when it convicts, it has one of two effects. Someone gives their lives to Christ, or someone is repulsed because they don't want to change. That's not our business. That's the Holy Spirit's job. But our job is to not let our anger produce unrighteousness within us. Our job is to be like Christ. Y'all might recall, there was really only two times when Christ became angry. Anyone want to shout out what those two times were? What did Jesus do when he got angry?
Cleared the temple.
He cleared the temple. And boy, did he. He turned tables over. He caused a whip. I don't know if anyone got hit with that whip. They might have. I mean, I'm pretty sure Jesus had 100% accuracy. He let loose all the animals. He turned the money tables over. Jesus was upset really only about one thing. It wasn't about what the Romans were doing. It wasn't about what King Herod was doing. It was about what the religious leaders were doing. Amen. And they were hindering the pure and undiluted worship of God. That's what should make us angry. When I come to the end of my life, I'm not going to be standing before an elephant or a donkey, but the lion and the lamb. And I am told that wrath is reserved for those who ignored his will. His righteous anger is produced for those who reject him over and over and over. And for those who sat in the seat of Moses and yet put weights upon the necks of those they weren't willing themselves to carry. In your anger, church, do not sin. It says, let the thief no longer steal. There's heart change. But rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. You understand something about this community that Paul is trying to talk about. This new life isn't merely something for us to look good to the outside world. It's for us to be that community together. And we may not have been thieves, but we have robbed God. We may not have been thieves, but we have done enough to send an innocent man to the cross. And our job now, our role now, is to be a part of a body that comes together and puts aside worthless, petty, useless arguments and agrees upon Jesus Christ and builds one another up, speaks the truth to each other, and helps with needs as any have them. This isn't the church. It's a beautiful building, but you are. You are bricks being built upon a spiritual foundation in which the cornerstone that the builders rejected, Jesus Christ, is holding you together. It's time to bring back community to the church. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths or your fingertips. That's what I would add in this day and age of social media. Let no corrupting talks come out of your mouths, but only such as good as is for building up as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. Now, uncorrupting talk, what does that mean? Here's a little illustration. Baptist friend of mine was at the store one day, and he heard two ladies talking about another person who was in the church. He said, "Ladies, are y'all gossiping?" She says, "No, preacher, we're asking for prayer requests." Now, I know it's a joke. It sounds more funny when it's somebody I know. But it's the truth. Slander, gossip, things that don't befit the body of Christ, those things need to leave our lips. And if we have a problem with somebody, Jesus doesn't say it's on them to come and forgive you or come and ask you for forgiveness. It's on you to go make it right. Jesus said, if you have something against your brother, or rather he says, if your brother has something against you, you go lay your offering down and you go make it right. Paul says, as far as it is from you, live at peace with all. John says, he who says he loves God yet hates his brother, that man is a liar. Corrupting talk is anything that comes out of our lips that does not bring honor and glory to God. And if by my words I hurt your feelings, but you come back to Christ, God is honored. I will hurt your feelings because I love you. And I hope you'll do the same for me. But I won't slander you. I won't talk about you behind your back. I'll do all I can to build you up in love. This topic just breaks my heart the way Christians talk about one another. It says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. This new life that you hold, what are you doing with it? This new life that Christ has given you through His blood and His suffering and His stripes, how are you using it? What you say and what you do absolutely matter. Christ doesn't call you to be a Christian on Sunday mornings only, but at your places of work, at your school, with your parents, with your children, with your spouses, with your girlfriends, with your boyfriends, with whatever else God may send you to, you are called to work out your salvation in every part of your life. And Christ just doesn't want to be a part of it. He wants to be the reason behind everything.
Amen.
However you walk, Paul also reminds us that we need to imitate God by walking in love. Listen to this. Chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant and offering and sacrifice to God. Do you hear that? We are made in the image of God. Christ died to restore us to that image. Let us therefore copy his example by picking up our cross and dying to ourselves for the sake of others. Imitate God. Live the example of Christ. Not all of us are called to be homeless and wander around and preach the gospel, but we are called to imitate him in our sacrificial love for one another. Now listen to this. But sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not be named among you as is proper among the saints. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place. But instead let there be thanksgiving. Someone makes you mad, be thankful to God. Someone does something you don't like, let praises come out of your lips to the God who can fix all things. Unwholesome talk has no room in the lips of the follower of Christ. I'm not telling you this so that you can say, I wish so-and-so could hear this. This message is for me as much as it is for you. Let's just put it all away. For you may be sure of this, that everyone who is sexually immoral or impure or who is covetous, that is an idolater. You hear that? He says covetousness isn't even necessarily, it's worshiping what someone else has. Has no inheritance in the kingdom of God or Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not become partners with them, for at one time you were in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. In other words, whatever the rest of the world is doing, you do what God is doing. There is no shadow in light. For the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. And how does Paul say we do that? Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may know what is the will of God, what is good and pleasing and perfect. And I'm going to contest to you today that you cannot know the will of God apart from the Word of God. So let us stand upon it firmly and hide its words in our heart. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. This is why I have no hope in politics. By my good conduct, the world will see my good works and give honor to my Father in heaven, according to Christ himself.
merely by living as I do. The reason the church suffers persecution the world over is light always exposes what goes on in darkness. Amen. And if we are living by the light, we are going to receive the persecution, but the Lord is at hand and he is faithful and he will give us the ability to endure it. And as he says over and over in Revelation, he who endures conquers. Or as he says to one church, for those who endure, I will give them the right to sit with me on my throne. Be patient. God is coming. Let us walk in his light. We need to pray this prayer that Paul speaks through the scriptures. Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Let's pray that for the church. That we don't need to be concerned with the affairs of this world that is passing away, but rather the eternity of the souls who are passing away. Amen. Let us make the gospel our reason for waking up in the morning. That we have been saved by Christ Jesus. That we have been bought and redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. And others can get that same thing we have. Amen. But we, the body of Christ, need to go out and boldly proclaim what he has done. You're not really going to be able to articulate apart from the Holy Spirit through the Word of God. Let us stand upon it and do the work of the gospel. Lastly, let us walk in wisdom. Paul writes in verse 15, look carefully then how you walk. Not as unwise, but as wise. Making the best use of the time because the days are evil. You know, I've had to ask myself this question on social media lately. Do I need to be here? Is this the best use of my time? Because this is the way the world works. It's a little distraction at a time. I'll go on to post something for the church, and then a half an hour, 45 minutes, an hour and a half later, I'm on there trying to not to comment on what people are saying. Or Betty, let's think about this. I turn on the news just to watch what's going on locally, and I end up watching TV for an hour and a half because, oh, look, it's a Friends marathon. I don't watch Friends, but I've heard that. There are so many little things in this life that distract us from what is important. And having small children, nothing is a clearer representation of that than the time I won't get back if I'm not making the use of my time. Church, let us ask God, as the scriptures say, to teach us to number our days. That in all aspects of our lives, all facets of it, from what we listen to on the radio to what we watch on TV, if we spend much time doing that at all, whether we're waking up or lying down, whether we're eating or drinking or going to work or going to school or whatever else we may be doing, all things we do may be brought to bear for the honor and glory of Jesus Christ. It says, do not get drunk, verse 17. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. Addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. I want y'all to look at this real quick. Paul gives four signs of being in the Spirit. Addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. How many of y'all have ever been encouraged when someone just gave you a melody from a song that was filled with the Lord? You notice the second one is just like it. Singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. What's a sign of joy? If you think about the things that our children do, some of the first things babies learn to do is sing. Think about it. Pure, undiluted joy. I remember when Lysander was, I'd say maybe 2 or 3 months old, Michael and I are sitting down having dinner. All of a sudden, I hear this hollering. And it sounds like he's in pain. And we run into the room, and he's sitting there going, and I'm trying to figure that out. And then Michael goes, you're always whistling every time he changes diapers.
And I recall that when he was still in her womb, every time there was a song playing in church, every time there was a melody, he would leap and dance in her womb. And our oldest son, some of y'all have seen it, he sings, and he's just been able to sing to the Lord, and he's musically talented. That's a sign. And some of us, we make a joyful noise to the Lord, and it ain't to anybody else, but we have joy. So we need to speak to each other in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs and sing and make melody to the Lord. This shows the joy in our hearts. Because someday, we're going to be around the throne of God, and what are we going to be doing? We're going to be singing. The voices of God's people as one in eternity, praising and singing songs before the Lord. Might as well get some start on it now. Then he says the third, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. A thankful heart is a sign of the Holy Spirit. And guess what? We can be grateful. I was thinking about this, and this has come up a lot, and I think I talked about this on Wednesday night, but it bears repeating. Corrie Ten Boom, who I speak of often, she was just a wonderful saint in the Lord. Was sent to Ravensbrück concentration camp. Her father was murdered for being too old, and there her sister also died of illness. But one day, she and her sister Betsy are in their dorm, and they're covered in fleas, and she's like, Betsy, how can I even be thankful for this? Betsy says, I'll get back to you on that. And so they're sitting there, and they're praying, and Betsy comes back to her. She says, sister, you're not going to believe this, but the inspectors don't want to come in because it's so full of filth and fleas. And if they found our Bible that we had smuggled in here, we'd be beaten and possibly killed. So they were able to have Bible study because of the fleas. People came to the Lord because of the fleas. And so Corrie Ten Boom, for the rest of her life, said, I will learn to be grateful even for the fleas. Gratefulness is a sign that you've been with Jesus. Because if you've been with Jesus and he's gotten a hold of your heart, ain't nothing can take that from you. Will you be thankful even for the fleas today? Let's get that last one up there, please. Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. That word submit is a hard word. Especially when we're getting in the marriage talks next week. That's going to be a tough one. I don't want to see any elbows being thrown. I will have a whistle and blow it on you if I see it. I'm just kidding. But what's this idea of submission mean? Godly submission. It means dying to yourself for the needs of others. Amen. Dying to your wants, wishes, and desires to build someone else up towards Christ. There's always our goal. As Brother Randy comes up, I want to ask you, are you seeing these four signs within your life? Do you build someone up and psalms and hymns and spiritual songs? Do you make melody to the Lord for no reason? I'm going to be honest with you. Sometimes when I'm driving, I love to drive long trips without the radio on, especially now that my truck doesn't have a radio that connects to the antenna. Sometimes I'll just start singing. I don't know if anybody else has ever experienced this, but I'll just start preaching to nobody who's there. The Lord will just start filling my spirit, and I can't help but sing, or I can't help but make melody, or I can't help but speak the truth of God. It's just a weird phenomenon that happens. But I can tell the Holy Spirit's been there. There are sermons I've preached that not a soul but my own has heard. There's songs that I've sung that I don't really know the words, so I can't repeat them to you. But the Lord was present. Are you giving thanks in all circumstances? Are you submitting to each other out of reverence for Christ? Church, let's take this new life that God has given us and let's walk in a manner worthy of Christ Jesus. Let's imitate him, forgiving each other, loving each other, not letting the sun go down on our anger, and walking in the newness of life. I'd like to invite anybody who's willing to come forward and pray to come forward now. If maybe you're not feeling any of this joy, maybe you're just needing prayer, because let's face it, every day, regardless of
who's in Washington is a day that we need the Lord. Come forward and get prayer. If you've never given your life to Christ and you want to experience this joy that we keep talking about, come forward. But whatever you do, don't take the newness of life for granted. Make everything, every moment, every action, every breath, every word count for Christ to honor Him in all things.
Loving Father, we're so grateful for just another day you've given us today, the blessings, the opportune time, Father, just the wherewithal which we could be here this morning, give you praise and honor. We thank you for the message we've heard. We thank you for the words that you put in Brian's heart and he brings forth to us. Father, we thank you for the many blessings that so graciously you bestow upon us each and every day. Father, dismiss us from this place as we go to study your word one more time for this day. Be with us throughout this day. It is yours in Christ's name.